First of all, Happy New Year, everybody. Thank you for coming. Let's make it a really good new year. This is one of the important projects for the district, so I appreciate seeing a great response from all of you. What we want to do this evening is let you know what the Facility Master Plan project is, talk to you about some of the considerations in putting it together, some of the ways that we're going to involve the public, and we're asking you to come to this meeting before we even go out to the public, because we want our parents and our staff to be integrally involved in the project. And so we wanted to give you a first shot at it, a first view of it, and we will encourage you in this meeting to continue to participate and sign up for the different things that we're going to be doing. It's about a 2 to 3 month public process that we'll be putting on to really gather support, gather information, and help to develop the plan for facilities for the district. So with that, what I'd like to do is introduce Dr. Sanchez to welcome you to the beginning of this process. Thanks.
I really don't know how my voice is going to hold up, so please bear with me. Whenever the weather goes from 40 degrees to 80 degrees to 30 degrees to 70 degrees, this tends to happen to me here. It's not something I'm really used to, so I apologize for my voice ahead of time. So the good news is my introduction will be very brief. But I do want to thank everybody for taking the time to come out this evening. It's very important for us to really be a district that isn't in a reactive mode, but rather in a forward-looking mode. That's so important. And if you look at all successful school districts, and if you look at all successful organizations, they're not reactive organizations. They're visionary organizations. And so what we're going to present today isn't something that we just thought of last week or a month ago. What we're about to present is an aspect of our 5-year strategic plan. And that 5-year strategic plan, the process for that began in January of 2014. So from January of 2014 to January of 2016, it's been 2 years in the making to get to this point. So this wasn't something that we just came up with. So what you're going to see presented at this point, and what you're going to hear us share with you, is part of a 5-year vision for the district. So we're now officially into our second year of that 5-year plan. And that second year of the 5-year plan said that we really needed to take a look at our school facilities. We needed to take a look at our facilities, not just from the point of view of what we need in the classrooms, but from the point of view of everything that has to do with our facilities in terms of 21st century learning spaces and technology, and are our classrooms and hallways and all other common spaces situated in a manner that reflects the business world of today and of the future? Or are our schools and hallways and classrooms and common spaces reflective of the factory era or of the industrial age? And if so, how do we move from the industrial age to the 21st century, the 22nd century, and ensure that our students aren't just ready for college, but are ready for anything, ready for employability, ready for university study, ready to serve the country, and are better and are best prepared? It's not a mystery that the 5-year strategic plan is a response to over 400 community members' voice. And our community, in that 5-year plan, did see that our facilities, though they've held up well over the years, many of them were built in the 50s and the 60s and the 70s. I think we only have one that was built in the last 10 years, and it's Maryville McCorkle Academy of Excellence. It's the only one we have built in the last 10 years. This facility, I believe, was built in the 60s. 50s. Oh, 50s. So, again, if you take a look, if you take a look at the facility, you can see that good upkeep does allow for the buildings to have a long life, but that upkeep, the older the building gets, costs a bit more, and it takes a bit more investment. And so, again, I appreciate everybody being here. I appreciate our school administrators, our principals. I appreciate our parents being here and our community members here. I hope that what comes out of this, you really understand that we know we can't do the work of improving our facilities and improving our district alone. It's something that we have to do together, and it's something that has to be a collective commitment of understanding from the people who are the end users, our students, the people who are in the buildings every day, our teachers, and the people who will continue to be educated in these buildings for years to come. So with that, I think that's about all I can handle. I do appreciate you all being here, and I'll turn it back over to Mr. Nodine, and look forward to your feedback. And again, thank you.
All right, as Dr. Sanchez says, this is a part of a strategic plan for the district that started in 2014. Before we even started that strategic plan and the development and the meetings that we had to begin that, we had audits that were done. We had a curriculum audit, efficiency audit. We looked at how we were utilizing buildings, and we did a demographic study. And all of those things informed that plan and helped to develop the strategic plan, and that's going from left to right. The facility master plan is one of 25 elements in the strategic plan. And we have done some assessments just for that. We've done a facility condition index, a technology condition index. We've done an educational suitability study of all the schools. All of those things were assessments that we did in the first year of strategic planning. Now what we want to do is take all of that information, take all the other elements of the strategic plan, and put them together in a facility master plan for the district. Now that may lead to a bond program and a bond election in November 2016. That depends on how things go with putting this together and whether there's support in the community and by the board to move a bond program forward. But that's really what we're moving toward, is let's put together a long-range facility plan and then look at what we can fund and what the funding sources are for that plan. So, these are some of the elements that we see, just to start off with, they're fairly general, in a facility master plan. What you have on the right are looking at facilities, looking at safety, and looking at transportation. So it's looking at adding capacity to transportation, improving the safety and the security of facilities, and making changes to facilities and improvement to facilities like roofs, heating and ventilation, and so on. These are kind of the needs, the must-haves. And on the right-hand side, what we have are things like, how can we move our facilities into the 21st century, project spaces, and so on. So we have interactive student learning. We are looking at how we can fund technology that reflects, as Dr. Sanchez said, the technology that's being used in the workplace, so we can gear our students toward being able to be successful in the workplace. And then also, can we also improve successful programs, expand successful programs? We looked at trying to do that with Dodge in previous years and didn't have the funding that we needed to do it. So we're looking at all of these types of things to make improvements to the district to move it into the future. Those two sides are really going to need to be balanced. We're going to need to balance those elements, because we've done some pretty tight work on HVAC and roofing so far, and we're looking at $300 million when you look at all of the different possibilities of facility needs, and that's a fairly good sized bond. And so we have to look at how we can create balance when we get into the final decisions on where the money is going to go if there is a bond. And that's one of the things that we're looking for, feedback in through this public process. We have had previous bond programs. I'm sure some of you have experienced it. We had an approach of every student, every school in the last bond program. We had 42 different line items. And so we were really, and I'll go through some of those in a minute, but we were really trying to hit all of the different areas that needed to be handled in the district. It was a $235 million bond. It lasted for 9 years. That bond was completed. There was an excellent citizen oversight with the Bond Fiscal Oversight Committee. And we didn't just take the bond and use it. We actually looked at how we could use the bond to leverage some additional funds. And we also looked at how we could refinance the bond to save some money in the long run. And as I'll point out in a minute, some of the projects actually ended up saving us money too. Here's some of the projects we did with the previous bond. We really focused on project-based learning and science labs, especially in the high schools. We looked at health and safety and improved the playgrounds, improved tracks like at Rincon. We put in gymnasiums, practice gymnasiums in virtually every high school. So there was a lot of work that was done to improve interscholastics. We also looked at how we could make the schools work better in terms of their face to the community. We had schools that people would go to and they wouldn't know how to get into the front door. And so we started working on improving the face of the buildings and how they attracted people to it. And we looked at how we could, as in this auditorium, which is what that picture is, how we could support the fine arts. And so we made a lot of auditorium renovations in the high schools. Oh yeah, that way. We also put together some new facilities. One of them was Westside Transportation. We were able to move some of our central buses out to Westside. By doing that, we were able to save about $700,000 every year. So basically, that facility has about a 9-year payback because we are saving fuel, we're saving wear and tear on buses, we're saving labor costs. And so that Westside Transportation facility was a very positive element of the last last bond program. We also put in, as Dr. Sanchez said, a new school. That's McCorkle. McCorkle now has been able to attract students. It has a small attendance area, and more than 50% of the students in McCorkle come from outside the attendance area to that school. And it's a school that, if you have a chance to go to it, I would encourage you to go to it. It's what we really wanted to do in terms of project-based learning, 21st century. And in fact, the architects for that school are here today, Swaim and Associates, and they'll be talking to you. And the whole team's here. So with that, what I'd like to do is I'd like to introduce Gio and Associates, Georgia Lacey. And they're going to be running the public participation portion of the program. She's going to go through what they've done so far, and then going to give you a survey to do right here. And then we'll total up the results of the survey before the end of the meeting so you can see what the results are before we leave. With that, Georgia.
Thank you. I'm Georgia Lacey, and this is Theo Serrano. We are an independent, third-party group hired to be objective as far as perception goes to the facility's master plan. To date, we've done a couple of surveys, including one on the key stakeholders interviews one-on-one. We're gaining a lot of insight on what needs to be done for a communication plan going forward. I'm going to turn it over to Theo, who's going to talk a little bit about what we've done so far.
So our discovery background, to date, I have some fantastic news in just a minute, but we've done 200 plus survey responses, analyzing preparation in our initial background research. we're continuing digital surveying, and we've done focus groups and town halls. Those are just beginning. This is actually our first community meeting right now.
Si hay una persona aquí si necesita hablar en español, or does everybody speak English? Anybody need an interpreter? All good.
So one of the very first thing we did is we met with key stakeholders. We did one-on-one interviews and asked them for suggestions on what they thought to start this ball rolling. So very interesting interviews, got started right away, and that was our first thing. The next thing we did is we went to November 16th at Tucson High, and we went to the advocacy info session and had about 100 responses there, and that was pretty interesting as well. We surveyed a mix of parents, teachers, community members, trying to get a wide range of responses. So the exciting part is we just had the principal send out information to everybody. You guys have probably already seen it. Maybe many of you have taken it. We have 600 plus responses from that email that stimulated on right before Christmas until now. So this survey that's online on the TUSD website, it's through the 11th. We are feeling that we'll probably have 800 plus responses, which is a pretty good statistical sampling. And we're encouraging you, if you haven't seen that or if you haven't told your peers about it, please do so. So we can get everybody else involved. We'd like to have over 1,000, but certainly 800 is a wonderful number, and we're at 620 or so right now. And it's very similar to the survey you'll be taking in just a moment. So the reason we want to take the survey, we want everyone to take it, is because we want to hear every single person's voice, community members, staff members, parents, teachers. And this is the start. You guys are a big influence, probably the biggest influence. And we want your voice. And this is the basis for beginning the Facilities Master Plan Survey. It's going to help us identify facility improvements, identify funding sources, and support our long-term strategic plan. So everyone, we want you, if you don't mind, to use this link here, tusd1.org/survey, to take a brief, maybe 10-question survey, multiple choice answers. If you can take out your phones right now, and please go to this link, tusd1.org/pre-survey. If anyone's phone doesn't work, I have a hard copy, because we really need your help. We need your voice.
Also, what's going to be really wonderful is at the end of this, we're going to be able to tell you the results right here with our crew in the back and give you some of the perception of what exactly in this room thinks about the facility's master plan and its identification. So it's real important. Plus, this is the first stage of your involvement. From here, we'll continue on helping you get involved with parents, teachers, as well as through town halls and further focus groups. This is an in-depth survey that we're able to look at exactly how to proceed.
Does anyone need a handwritten hard copy survey? Okay,
put your hand
see
up.
You. One, two, three. If you keep your hands up, we'll come right around to you, okay? And it should take literally 5 to 7 minutes to take the survey, so we appreciate your time. Again, you are the most important voice.
Brian right here. You have another one?
I'll get to it, Brian.
Looks like people are starting to wrap up, but we're going to keep it going for at least 5 more minutes to make sure everybody is able to finish. And for those of people who have finished, go ahead and you can take a break. There's water, coffee, food outside. Grab that, and we'll just wait a little bit longer and make sure everybody can finish.
Thank you. I don't know if it's the one that's going to solve the stuff. Try to help me collect these.
Take a 5-minute break. Don't leave though, because it's really interesting, the rest of this presentation as well as the live results.
Is there anyone still taking the survey? All right, everybody, if you can take your seats, we're finalizing the survey now, and everybody in the hall, Mitch, if you'll help me, gather everyone in the hall. And I'm going to turn it over to Brian right now. Is everybody done with the survey? Thank you very much. I'm going to have close to live results in about 10 minutes. So we'll turn it back over to Brian to continue the presentation. Thank you.
All right, thanks for doing that for us. It's important information to understand how you feel, and we're also wanting to understand how the rest of the community feels. So let them know about the survey that's on the website. And one other thing, even if you've taken the survey will change as this process goes along so that we can get the information we need for the right part of the process. So we'll announce when new surveys come out and are online. All right, I'd like to talk to you about funding right now. So you can all put your heads down and go to sleep. But I want to talk to you about capital funding, because capital funding in TUSD and really in Arizona for all the school districts has almost virtually dried up. Over the last 10 years, we've lost $100 million in capital funding available to us in total. And you can see every year, this graph shows what we had in 2008-2009. All of the blue area was what we had in capital funding, and it was in the high 20 million range. That's gone down now to 3.5 million. The red shows what we essentially did not get funded, which we should have had funded. And the reason that red goes down a little bit over time is because our student population went down, so we would have gotten less capital funding anyway. But you can see the tremendous change. We're at just a little over 10% of where we were 9 years ago, 8 years ago, with capital funding. So what do you do about that? Well, what a lot of districts do now is they use bonds to replace the capital funding. Now, bonds are really designed to renovate facilities, to build new facilities, and to do that kind of big capital project. But what's happening is, because we've lost so many capital funds, some of what's happening with bonds now is it's handling deferred maintenance. So in other words, a roof doesn't get repaired, and it gets patched and patched and patched for years, and then you have to go in and you have to put a whole new roof on. And that's deferred maintenance. So that's a lot of what's happening with bonds now, and that's why I talked to you about the extent of the bond that's needed just for basic repairs to facilities. What are bonds? Bonds are monies that are approved by voters in a package that's fairly specific in terms of what the bonds will do. They have to be approved by the voters, and they have to be used for capital projects. So they're defined when they go to the voters for approval. The other thing is they have to be based on how much the district can really afford to bond, based on the capacity of the district, the capacity of the taxes, the property taxes in the district. And so it is based on property taxes. TUSD's bonding capacity is very high. What you can see here is the top line is our total bonding capacity, and the bottom line, the yellow line, is what we actually have been paying in bonds on an annual basis. So what you can see is right now we've been paying down the bonds that we got in 2004 at $235 million to the point where we could fund three times as much as that with the bonding capacity that we have. That actually puts us in a good position for being rated and having our bonds rated and being able to get lower interest. The other thing I want to talk about is taxes, because it's a property tax is what's used to fund the bonds. We've been working at keeping our tax rate fairly steady. You can see that it was higher about 8 years ago. It went down, and then as assessed valuations changed, because I think everybody's seen it in their homes. The property values have decreased, that property tax rate has fluctuated. And so regardless, we've been working at trying to keep it at a fairly steady rate for the last years. What is it going to cost to do a bond? That's an important thing that everybody is going to know, everybody in the public, and so we put that together. Carla, our Soto, who does all our financing, put that together and looked at it. So what you can see there is, the on the left is the bond election amount. So if we went out for a $100 million bond, the estimated annual cost in the third column per $100,000 of home value would be basically $20. If we went out for a $250 million bond, then it would be $42 per $100,000. And then up to the maximum bonding capacity, basically, $450 million, it would be an additional $73 per $100,000 valuation on your home. So that gives you a feeling for what the impact might be. So a $200,000 home, let's take the middle one, that would come out to about $80 a year. Basically, we're looking at about $6, $7 a month per household, I should say. So that's what the impact would be on taxpayers. So with that, what I'd like to do is introduce you to Phil Swain with Swain and Associates, and he's going to talk about some of the things that we've done. He's done interviews with a lot of people in the district. He's visited some of the schools. He knows them well. He's going to talk about some of the ideas that we have for the bond funds and for the facility master plan and what things we should look at for the future of TUSD.
Good evening, everybody. It's really great to be able to see people here and have a chance to talk about improving school facilities. And it's also kind of exciting. I'm a product of TUSD, so hopefully that's a really good thing. Went to Lizzie Brown and McGee and Sabino High School, and now having my daughter be a senior at Sabino is certainly very exciting. We've got a great team. Have a chance to be able to be here to help the district out here tonight with one of my partners, Mark Ballard, at Swaim Associates. Mark and I have been working together for 30 years now, designing school facilities. We've been involved with over 300 school facility projects, a lot here at TUSD, including renovating a major number here in the district, and as well as Maribel McCorkle School. A lot of town around the Southwest U.S., and now we're even international, that we completed a school in Jamaica. So we've expanded out in our horizons. We've also here with our teammate Molly Smith of Think Smart Planning. She's a certified educational facilities planner, works around the country helping school districts out and things like this. We've worked with Molly on several schools, including McCorkle, a new STEM school at AmFi, and some of the Vail schools, and really creating some cutting edge, exciting school facilities. We also have on our team facilities management group. They are a team with a lot of experience that actually help to produce maintenance and bond programs and actually implement and manage school facilities and things. So they give a real practical side to the team to help us move through. All right. There's a lot of ways that we can look at improving schools. And I guess, to be honest, as an architect, I'll be the first to admit that it's not all about, certainly not all about buildings. It's about teachers, and it's about engaging students and parents in the schools. On the other hand, school facilities really can make a huge difference. And so we'd like to be able to look at those in these sort of categories and arrange, at least for discussion purposes tonight, for just basic maintenance, on upgrading the facilities we have, focusing on specific programs and curriculum, as well as school size and organization. Maintenance. It's the boring part of taking care of schools, but on the other hand, we have to be able to take care of what we have now. Certainly, roofs are a major part of that. It's probably one of the major complaints when you have leaking roofs and destroying buildings. That's an important piece of what we have to look at. Our air conditioning systems, that is the number one complaint we have and the biggest influence on really creating a comfortable educational environment. And so it's important that we're able to deal with the day-to-day maintenance and unfortunately have to replace systems as we go along. Certainly electrical systems, our fields and playgrounds, we need to look at taking care of our parent drop-off areas and improving those facilities. And finishes. I mean, just carpet and paint and everything else and cabinets that just get a lot of wear and tear in a school environment. Upgrades is really the next level that we're looking at. How can we really enhance what we already have and take advantage of that? Certainly, energy efficiency is a great way that we can get payback, whether it's with solar, more energy efficient mechanical systems and lighting, as well as just sort of teaching the reality of the environmental issues. Technology is something that we need to be able to make sure that we improve the backbones to be able to give you guys the tools to be able to teach and learn. With bonds, we can't buy the equipment on the user end in terms of the smart boards and the computers. But again, if we can get your feedback about those priorities, we want to be able to hear that so we can find ways to be able to include that within a facilities master plan. Security is certainly an issue that we need to address, whether it's with fencing, upgrading hardware and access control, adding security cameras, and at a minimum be able to have a single controllable access into a school. Acoustics is one I jumped over, but being able to upgrade acoustics within a school, within classrooms and multi-purpose environments, really makes that educational environment much better and allows you to actually teach and kids to hear and learn. And even aesthetics. I mean, it's something that really improving the aesthetics of a school. It makes the students and the parents and teachers, everybody proud of where they're at and take ownership. This is a photo of an old dining hall that in a high school that we upgraded and really became a central commons and cyber cafe, and it's really become a hub of the school. So that's amazing what we can do even just with aesthetics. Another key way that we need to be able to look at is focusing on specific curriculum or programs. And Brian mentioned those with some of our magnet programs. What can we really do to be able to take it and launch those to the next level and create those great facilities? Certainly with better science facilities. And now in some of the high schools, we may have already hit that with the last bond, but in our middle schools and K-8s and even the elementary schools, providing additional facilities for engineering or greenhouse facilities and other things to really take that next step for the programs. Arts, certainly improving auditoriums like this and for both fine and performing arts. I mean, it really inspires our students. And one of the things we've learned as architects and planners is one of the most important things is to be able to reach out and somehow inspire a student in school, whether it's band or athletics, or a great teacher in the arts, or whatever it might be. And certainly the arts is a way to be able to do that. Support the magnet programs. You've got some great things going on, but sometimes it's just that extra level of facility to be able to deal with some of the programs you've got going on that can make a difference. Career and technical education has really reached out and inspired a lot of students, whether it's just the vocational programs we're seeing in high schools. But we're seeing kids in auto shop go on into engineering in college. Obviously, all the medical programs and biotech, et cetera. It's really amazing what you can do with that. And now with some of that funding is being cut, how can we support that? And maybe even start reaching down into the middle schools to have programs to support and inspire the kids as they move forward. One-to-one laptops. The more that many schools are trying to be able to go and provide that level of technology for mobile devices for every student, and not just in high schools, but even in the lower grades as well. And so providing the infrastructure, the wireless systems, the technology centers, and other things to be able to support that is something we ought to consider. And certainly athletics. It's a big part of schools and what we learn out of. And so we need to consider those facilities as well. Even at some of the middle schools, we're realizing, I think we've done a pretty good job at the high schools maybe, but some of the middle schools maybe now with being able to upgrade and provide some facilities there to really hit on those. And the other thing is size and organization. Schools are communities, and so the size and how those communities are put together really makes a difference. Of the right scale to provide that curriculum and that social network within the school. We need to look at the grade structure, whether it's the traditional elementary, middle school, and high school, hear about the K-8s and how that's being successful to transform those. Even the population of those K-8s, again, is for the middle schools to be able to have enough curriculum and the right balance there. Or some of the other innovative approaches that we're currently looking at and moving 7th or 6th and that sort of thing, or K-12 schools, a variety of things we should be looking at there, as well as threads throughout the district. I mean, again, you've got some really successful programs, whether it's at some place like Dodge or some of the great things you've got in high schools, but developing those threads, so starting in elementary school so the kids have that project-based learning as they move up through the different schools, or the science, or whatever that is. And so really creating some continuity to be able to really create some great things as we're moving forward. So I think there's a lot of things that are going to influence our ideas about priorities of where to be able to move on the facilities master plan. But certainly one of the most important things is where we are in our real world. I mean, our goal is to be able to raise our students, our young people, to be able to be ready for the careers of today and the future. I love the fact that Dr. Sacha said it wasn't just the 21st century, but we're looking at the 22nd century now. And out in the real world, they're STEM careers. And this is where, and certainly in Tucson, that we're going, whether it's with biotech and optics and aerospace and all the science. We're working with some pretty neat aerospace firms right now that on a project that will be announced next week. This is the careers that our students want to be able to and need to be able to get into. It's also about it's about collaboration. Out in the real world out there, we're no longer doing projects on our own, whether it's we're collaborating within our own firm or with other firms within the community. We can't do this on our own. So the kids need to be able to have that ability to learn about that and practice that in the school, as you know. And certainly technology, as part of our everyday lives, and as it continues to rocket forward, we want to be able to have that in our schools and make sure the kids can master that and not have it master them and direct that. So does that really influence our 21st century education? Certainly it starts with that STEM and STEAM, including the arts, and making sure we've got those great facilities, again, in engineering and science. The STEM, even elementary schools now, we can't give these young students enough credit with their understanding and how they're excited about what they're learning and what they can do. But STEM is not just for middle and high schools. Project-based learning. A lot of our students, as we know, learn better by doing. They want to know at this point why what they're learning is relevant. They don't necessarily need the lecture and memorization the way that we used to. And so, again, our education is transforming and to provide that opportunity. So we need to transform our schools to provide those breakout spaces for collaboration, whether it's transforming some of the corridors into the breakout areas or other spaces to provide those group spaces. We need project space, project labs and things where we can actually have the students build projects and not have to take them down every hour or every day, but leave them up and really be able to thrive and be excited about that. Certainly with technology, we need the infrastructure so that they've got the tools, you've got the tools to be able to teach and utilize them in these projects. Sustainability is a part of 21st century education. It's great to be able to have conservation and recycling and energy efficiency as part of what the students are learning. It's neat talking with students of all ages and see how inspired they are about sustainability and how that ties in with their education. Social aspects, I think, that we need to be able to deal with. We sometimes forget about those issues, especially now that our kids are dealing so much with texting and emailing and with computer technology. They need to still have those social aspects to be able to bring them together. We're seeing more with student commons, and both indoors and outdoors, and create the different way for them to be able to get together and thrive and communicate. And obviously our schools are a really key part of that. And community. We need to obviously bring the community into our schools. We know it's great for parental connection and a sense of ownership of the schools. There's sometimes, I think, a misunderstanding out in the community about Tucson Unified and other schools. But if we can get them here into our schools, it's amazing when they turn around and say, I had no idea what you're doing here. And so I think getting the school, the community involved in our schools is really important to have that commitment, get that financial connection and support as we're going forward with these sort of things. So, with that in mind, if I can click here correctly, what are the benefits? I mean, first of all, certainly it's a better learning environment, and that's most important of what we're trying to be able to do. We can reduce maintenance and reduce costs to put those dollars right back in the classroom. We can provide teachers the facilities that you really need and deserve to really thrive and concentrate on education, inspiring your students. And ultimately, that is what we're trying to do, is inspire students, make learning irresistible, inspiring parents. If we can get them to want to come to our schools, we improve attendance, which increases our state funding, which gets us more money back into school to do more things, which then it sort of spirals up as opposed to spiraling down. So the opportunities here are really amazing. Now, the challenge, as Brian mentioned, is we have to balance our needs. We can't do everything. So that's why we really need you to be able to give us your feedback of what you think are the priorities. Where should we be focusing? This is not something that's just going to happen in 1 year or so in a bond program. That's why we're wanting to understand how we can phase these sort of things. Where can we have the biggest impact, whether it's maintenance or focusing on education and curriculum. Again, we need to understand the priorities, and that will allow us to really create a long-term facilities master plan so we can be proactive and not just reactive and really make us all proud of where we're going. So with that in mind, I don't know if the group, we're good? Great, so I think we've got the latest survey results to be able to see what you think, so thank you.
So we're just switching out the PowerPoints. We've already collected all the data from everyone here that's taken. With the exception of, there is probably 20 or so hard copy surveys. We'll add that into the mix later. But for the 120 plus digital surveys, we already have the results to go over, and I think you'll find it fascinating. We'll delve right in, okay? So there's 145 digital surveys out of roughly 160 attendees. So thank you very much for taking the time to do that. It helps us get a really round, complete consensus of what everyone's thinking. Here we go. Developing a 10-year facility plan, including plan and funding program, is it positive for TUSD? Every single one of you said yes, 100%. I'm going to give you averages here. We can get into the numbers. If anyone has any questions, please raise their hand. But I'm going to give you the averages so we can get through these 10 or so questions. Do you feel the conditions of school buildings and building systems support education? Elementary, average. Again, 3's average, a little lower, really no, towards the no scale. Middle school, 2.91 is the average. And high school, about 3.25. So really middle of the road on that particular question. Do you feel schools have the technology infrastructure and devices needed? Elementary, no, 2.24. Middle school, no, 2.39. High school, no, 2.75. Do you feel schools provide a safe and secure environment? Elementary school, 3.6. Middle school, 3.21. High school, 3.23. So middle of the road. How important are the following providing a 21st century education? STEM, 4.61. Project-based learning, 4.5 out of 5. Physical education, interscholastic activities, 4.23. Fine arts, 4.38. Continuing career and technical education, 4.53. High academics and college prep, 4.61. Global studies and dual language, 4.17 out of 5. Please rank the following issues that you feel are important to address for the facilities master plan and possibly a bond. Playgrounds, fields, athletics, 3.56. 21st century education, 4.5 out of 5. Student pickup drop-off, 3.44 out of 5. Energy efficiency and reduced operating costs, 4.02. Continuing that, please rank the following issues you feel are most important to address for the facilities master plan and possibly a bond. School facilities maintenance, 4.38 out of 5. Buses and transportation, 3.61 out of 5. Security of students and staff, 4.43 out of 5. Basic education, 4.5 out of 5. Technology, 4.59 out of 5. To what extent would you support a bond for school improvements through increased property taxes? 42% said $100 annual increase, followed by $60 annual increase of 19%. It's pretty telling, and thank you guys for taking that time to do that. We're gonna switch over really quick. Does anyone have any questions first? Okay, so we're almost done. We're gonna switch over slides real quick. And as you leave today, I'm jumping one slide ahead, but as you leave today, we're gonna give you a business card. You took the survey without really hearing the rest of the costs and the rest of the analysis and Phil Swain on the building side of it and the development side of it. We want you to take that survey one more time. It's slightly different, but it asks a lot of the same questions. We've pared it down to make it even faster for you to take it, but it's important to see if your perception has changed at all. If it hasn't, no problem, answer the same. But it'll help us gauge whether or not we're explaining it correctly to you or whether your feelings have changed on it. So we want you to get the word out, please. As we said, we have 600 plus. We're expecting approximately 800 on the TUSD facility survey that's on the TUSD website right now. And that's important because we want everyone's voice. Everyone needs to participate in this so we can get the entire perspective from parents to teachers to staff to community members. So send your school community to the TUSD website until the 11th. There's the facility survey on there. So if you haven't taken that one, it's slightly different than this one, please take it and tell your coworkers, friends, family, parents to go ahead and take it. Send out to your email list. Please put it in the superintendent newsletter. Get involved, public meetings, town halls, this meeting right here. We have two upcoming meetings, town halls, January 16th and 19th. Please, if you could attend, that would be wonderful. We need your help. And we're conducting three sets of focus groups. So we're trying to develop solutions, refine solutions, and recommend solutions. So these three sets of focus groups are coming up. So please, if you're interested, let someone know. And we want you involved in those focus groups. So here's the survey business card that my colleagues will be giving you on the way out. It's pretty simple. Again, it's a pared down version of the one you just took. And we're pleased asking you to have that same type of wonderful participation, almost 100% participation from the survey, if you'll please take it again. I promise you, we pared it down just to ask very few questions on that second survey, so it shouldn't take but maybe 3 to 5 minutes, if that, of your time, okay? Are there any questions? Well, I'd like to say thank you all very much. And
here's a question.
In closing, I'd like to introduce Dr. Sanchez coming up, or Bryant. So thank you very much for taking the survey and being engaged.
I just want to tell you a little bit more about the focus groups. What we're going to be doing is three sets of focus groups, with one for elementary, one for middle, and one for middle and K-8, and one for high school and alternative, so that we can focus on the things for those areas, for those topics. And we're going to have three meetings of each focus group. The first one will be helping us develop ideas to expand on some of the things that we've done through our interviews and our surveys. The next one will help us refine those ideas, and then the last one will start to prioritize those and make recommendations on how to spend money. So please let us know that you want to be involved in those focus groups. You'll find on the survey that Theo just gave you that there will be a question there that says, do you want to be involved in the focus groups and which ones? So let us know. Okay, thanks. With that, Dr. Sanchez.
Let me see what kind of... I may be whispering into this thing by the time it's all said and done, so I just had a few questions. My first question is, how many of you over the holidays received a gift? How many of you received a gift? Just raise your hand. All right. Now be honest, how many of you who received a gift told the person who gave you the gift what you wanted? Of those of you who told the person who gave you the gift what you wanted, were you happy with the gift? Right? That pretty much boils down our process. We want to be sure that if there is a bond, or as this plan rolls forward and there are buildings built and facilities enhanced, it's what you want. It's what you feel our kids need. And as educators, it's what you feel is important. And with that, I'm done. Thank you so much.